As Rome died, a man in Athens sat hard at work. His name was Proclus, and he had made perhaps the most monumental discovery of the age. He had discovered that the solution to Euclid's postulate 5 offered by Ptolemy, the other great mathematician of the ancient world, was false. More still, he had found a solution himself. He wrote furiously through the night. Unfortunately, his solution was false too. Let the 2,000 years of head-scratching begin. Chaos, war, fire, and famine. The fall of empires. Western Rome collapsed, and with it, many of its institutions, including its system of education, were washed away. Old ideas, old books, vanished from the West. And one of those books was The Elements. For nearly 700 years, the beautiful geometry of Euclid and the Greeks would disappear from Europe. But there was somewhere else, somewhere further east, that safeguarded this knowledge and kept the light of Rome alive. This was Eastern Rome, the Byzantine Empire, shield of fledgling Europe while it clawed its way back from its great collapse. But it's not from the Byzantines that we get Euclid back, at least not directly. You see, while the Eastern Roman Empire was on its long, slow decline, there was another power on the rise, Islam. And during the Islamic Golden Age, the Abbasid caliphs sent scholars and traders up to Constantinople to acquire and translate as many works of ancient thought as they could. And one such work was Euclid. During the Islamic Golden Age, massive strides were made in mathematics, building off the texts of antiquity. Algebra was systemized for the first time, trigonometry was pushed well beyond anything the ancient world knew, and irrational numbers, that dark heart of mathematics which the Pythagoreans felt ruined its perfection, were brought into the light. While dabbling in Euclid, the great poet-mathematician Omar Khayyam took a huge step forward in number theory by deciding that you could put irrational numbers on the same number line as rational ones. This was something that had totally confounded Euclid, because Euclid had wanted a tool that could measure everything, and there was no line segment, no matter how small you made it, that could be laid out evenly to measure both a rational number and an irrational number. So he had viewed them as totally separate things. Khayyam, on the other hand, realized that, hey, you can still tell that pi is bigger than 1, so they must have some relation. And this is a big deal, because it lets us do things with irrational numbers. This brings us to the famous polymath Al-Khwarizmi, who was not only a strong advocate for the use of the Hindu numbering system, which would become what we call the Arabic numerals today, but he expanded on the geometry of Euclid to write a book that gives us the very word algebra today. To show you just how much Euclid was a basis for his algebra, let's real quick do a quadratic equation the way that Al-Khwarizmi did them. Al-Khwarizmi had this famous equation where he wanted to solve x squared plus 10x equals 39. Instead of using the quadratic equation like we might today, he literally made a square of x and drew the thing. So, step one, let's lay out a line and call it x units long. Step two, put another x unit long line at a right angle to your first line and make a square out of the two. So now we have x squared. Step three, add 5 units to the right side of your square, and make a rectangle using that extra bit and the height of the square. So you get a rectangle attached to our square, 5 long and x wide. Step 4. Do the same thing with the bottom side, so you end up with another rectangle, 5 wide and x long, attached to the bottom of your square. So, now we have x squared plus 5x plus 5x, or, put another way, x squared plus 10x, which is starting to look a lot like our original equation. But you'll notice that our square is no longer square. Now there's a hole in the bottom corner. But luckily, we know just how big that hole is. It's exactly 5 by 5, or 25 units large, because of how we constructed the rest of the square. But what do we also know from our original equation? We know that x squared plus 10x, or everything but that little missing square here, equals 39. So if we were to add that little square in, we would have an area of 39 plus 25, or 64. But we'd also now have a perfect square with each side being x plus 5 long. So now we know that x plus 5 squared equals 64. Or, put another way, the square root of 64 equals x plus 5. And the square root of 64 is 8, so 8 equals x plus 5, which means that x must be 3. Congratulations, you just did a quadratic equation using nothing but geometry. And the reason I walked you through all of that was to show you just how smart and thorough the guy who figured that out had to be. Al-Khwarizmi was smart. And you know what bugged him? Postulate 5. So he charged mightily at it, and he did come up with a proof for it, that unfortunately was invalid because it relied on things like motion and transformation in a totally static geometrical system. It was a good try, though. And that poet I mentioned, Omar Khayyam, man did the fifth postulate get his goat. He wrote a full book on the thing, and he came up with a proof, which unfortunately was really just a rewording of Euclid's original postulate. Almost every Islamic mathematician you can name in the Middle Ages took a crack at this. In one case, a mathematical family even passed it down between generations, with a son taking up his father's work on perfecting Euclid and eliminating the fifth postulate. But in the end, none succeeded. Still though, they did advance mathematics phenomenally, and built a foundation which later Europeans would use to get to non-Euclidean geometry. Because in their attempts to eliminate Postulate 5, some of the Islamic geometers stumbled on a method that they thought foolproof. They said, well, there are only two other possibilities for parallel lines other than Euclid's Postulate 5. If these supposedly parallel lines don't always maintain the same distance apart, that means they either have to cross sometime, or they have to bend away from one another. If we can just disprove both of those ridiculous cases, then bam, postulate 5 solved. Of course, we know now that those other two cases aren't actually that ridiculous. In fact, they are the two main forms of non-Euclidean geometry. But it'll take a few centuries for us to get there. So in the meantime, how did the elements and the problem of postulate 5 make its way back into Europe? Well, a 12th century Englishman named Adelard spent a very long time wandering around the Crusader states. He really wasn't too impressed with how all of these crusades seemed to be going, but if there was one thing they succeeded at, it was providing access to the academic knowledge of the Islamic world. I mean, why let a little crusade get in the way of some good scholarship? So Adelard took all of these awesome books he found in Crusader country back to an abbey in England, and he began to translate them. And amongst this haul was Euclid's The Elements. His translation served as the basis for all Western versions of this book for 600 years, until Napoleon accidentally stole an older copy from the Vatican that they just didn't realize they had. But that is a story for another time. Join us next week as Adelard's translations begin to spread, and we see the influence of Euclid on the West, and what Renaissance Europe will do with his ideas.